You know, what if I just did the entire episode like this? And just not make any mention at all about what it is on top of my head.
A little bit. Welcome to Table Talk, this show about beer, board games, and everything else. I'm Rich.
And I'm Alex. And this week we're going to continue our discussion on America.
America!
Bald Eagle. Cannon fire. The sound of baseball.
Oh, you got this down.
Yeah, that's
you've been practicing since I it seems like.
Yeah. You got the saluting though. I feel like I'm my hand is
yeah, you're a little little this, but that's okay. Yeah. It's all right.
I was not in the military, so
I had to go through basic training where I was also doing this, and then they're like, Rah! And I was like, okay, fine, I'll do this then. And get nice and straight, and you kinda had to tilt a little bit too.
And what was their response after that?
Better. Now go run 500 miles.
Yeah. Oh, thanks. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Yeah. Yes. Welcome to part two, everybody. This is part two of our America series. If you didn't catch part one, go back and check it out. We paired. Yeah, it was great. Yeah, we can say that. It was awesome. It was revolutionary.
You think they had the drum roll thing, the ba-dum ching, like, but in colonial sound?
Yeah, right. I just watched the Patriot. I told you that last episode. They didn't have the cymbal on the drum, on the colonial drum. There wasn't like a little cymbal up here where he go, right.
You know, I always thought that people were on the nose back then, but it makes sense because there's no symbolism.
There's a good sound effect for trombone. That's where I'll put my trombone sound right there, right after that joke. Goodness. Part two. If you didn't check out part one, we paired Samuel Adams. We paired the summer ale for Samuel Adams with a great American Revolution board game called Hold the Line, the American Revolution. Go back and check that out. If you want to learn more about how to play that game, there's a link in that description as well. We're moving on, like we always do. We are jumping into the rabbit hole and talking about colonial America for this episode, and we're going to dive into some other topics of conversation later on here in the next couple of weeks, all the way through the great month of July, which belongs to our independence on the 4th of July. So I hope everybody had a good 4th of July. I was actually in a parade. I don't know what you did, Alex, but I was
in a
parade. I know. I didn't tell you this. I threw candy from a wagon to strangers.
Threw candy in a wagon at strangers. Got it.
The wagon. I wasn't outside of the wagon throwing candy at strangers into the wagon. I was in the wagon throwing candy outside of the wagon to strangers sitting nearby.
Between, under, through, over.
Yes.
Got it.
Yeah. Okay. Yep. Kind of a good story there. My dad has a tractor that belonged to his father. So it's very kind of sentimental. That he got to basically kind of fix it up a little bit. And then there was a wagon that also belonged to his father that he remembers using when he was a kid. He grew up on a dairy farm. Mm-hmm. So he kind of fixed the wagon up as well. And got to pull it through the Sheridan, Indiana 4th of July parade. It's kind of a big deal there in that town. That's the town that my mother grew up in, and that's where my grandparents live on my mother's side. So it was kind of like a family thing that we did, right?
Yeah, that's great.
When I was little, that we would go to the parade, and now I got to be inside the parade. And shout out to Rupert from Survivor. If you're a Survivor fan and you know who Rupert is, he always comes down to Sheridan, Indiana for our 4th of July parade.
Well, look at that. All right.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, and I saw him. I didn't introduce myself because he looked a little angry. He's a little older now. He's a little. He kind of has that like resting grumpy look, you know, kind of that, okay. that some older gentlemen have. So, but I saw him and his wife, and I kind of just stared in admiration from a distance. Actually, not even from a distance. He kind of like just breezed right by me, and I was like, "That was Rupert."
Wow.
Oh my god.
Wow.
And if you're not a Survivor fan, you don't know what I'm talking about, but. Tie-dye guy from Survivor. What'd you do for 4th of July, Alex?
What did I do? We hosted some friends here in Raleigh, which was fantastic. We kind of did the whole, like, visit Raleigh kind of thing. We went to the North Carolina Museum of Art, which mm-hmm. Has some outdoor art trails and stuff, which is fun.
Mm-hmm.
And then we went to downtown Raleigh, tried a few, tried a brewery down there, and then I had lots of good food. And then the actual 4th of July was spent us kind of, we didn't launch any fireworks ourselves, but promptly about 9 p.m., all of a sudden you know, going all over the place.
Yeah, yeah.
There's a neighbor who's lighting a little one, you know, a little fuse or things, which I should add, those things are, I'm amazed that people don't blow their hands off more than actually happen. It's pretty amazing. But so right. that happens, and then you hear it in the background, it all, you know, going off, and you see two kids, you know, bike past us, you know, and they're, this was cool, they you hear them say, "Happy 4th of July," as yeah. they, you know, they bike past us, we're like, yeah, yeah, happy 4th. Then I realized, you know what they're doing? They're going alley to alley in our neighborhood, seeing who's launching fireworks, and they got tickets to the best show on earth. They're just taking their bikes yeah. and, you know, biking all around.
Right.
Yeah, then by like 9:45. All were done, and then we went inside and finished Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade. So,
nice.
It's a good way to finish things off.
Fantastic. I love how bikes always find a way into your stories.
There's always a
bike somewhere.
Oh,
hanging
yeah.
out.
Oh yeah. It's just one of those things.
Do you like backyard fireworks? Is that something that you did as a kid?
I grew up not doing it ourselves in our yard, yeah. but would go to a kind of an annual traditional party
okay.
where that was a thing. Yeah. That was the 3rd of July that was hosted by my godparents' parents.
Okay.
And they did it for like close to 30, 40 years or something like that.
Okay.
And now they've one has since passed, and the other one they basically changed locations for where that party's hosted.
Mm-hmm.
And then on actual July 4th, we would usually go to the Arlington County Country Club, which is the Arlington, which is where the FBI and the Pentagon and, you know,
right.
something like that is right across the Potomac.
Yeah.
And that's where we'd see like the show. On
yeah, July the 4th. Actual show. You had the pre. Show. You always have the pre-show, right?
Right.
Like
right.
that backyard type of fireworks type of thing,
right.
and then you have
right.
the like actual
the
show,
yeah, yeah, the big one, and right. and that was always fun. And then on not a lot, but on occasion we would actually go in the heart of DC, and we'd usually go to like a, and then we'd go to like a 4th of July thing because obviously DC's, you know, that's the place. So
mm-hmm.
The fireworks are pretty cool, and we would.
I've seen the fireworks in Washington DC.
Oh yeah,
been there.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's cool. It's cool, man. Yep. The United States Marine Corps band would play a lot of like American traditional, like John Philip Sousa and stuff like mm-hmm. that.
Yeah.
So that was a lot of fun to witness and also realize, especially now, is how lucky we were growing up that we had like these world class musicians mm-hmm. just on our doorstep, essentially, and it was all for free. So that was
mm-hmm.
that was yeah. pretty cool.
Yeah, so. It was pretty cool seeing fireworks next to like the Washington Monument. Like something about that kind of stuck in my head. It's like, yeah, this is really cool. And I was pretty young by the time
yeah.
we did that.
It's emotional, man. Well, and in 2019, I don't know if you remember this, but it was the 50th anniversary of the moon landing.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And they had a whole show. I'll have to send this to you. They had a whole show dedicated to that where the projection screen projected onto the Washington Monument.
Really?
So it was a vertical projection. But they use it as a way to show like the Saturn V rocket and the, and the lunar and the LEM, and then they would have big screens on the right and left that would show like footage of the astronauts, you know, Michael Collins and Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin and stuff.
Yeah.
It was super cool. I wasn't there in person. my dad was, and I have since seen the whole recording, but it's really cool.
All right. Yeah, absolutely. Well, we're already kind of diving into the aftermath of like all of that has to do with the aftermath of what we're talking about. We need to start honing in, Alex, and focusing in on why we celebrate 4th of July to begin with. And why why we have fireworks in our backyards and everything like that every 4th of July. So let's dive into that. But before we do, we do have some sponsors to thank. So I'm going to go ahead and start it off with a shout out to our sponsors. But while we do that, in an effort to keep everybody engaged, Alex is going to try and balance a Rubik's cube on top of his head. And I understand all you listeners out there, you may not be able to see this. This is a visual bit. Please remember to watch us on YouTube with Table Talk Alex.
This is another reason why YouTube, you should be watching this. Yeah.
Yes, you should be watching us on YouTube, but we understand if you're on the go, put us in your ears. We're happy to be there too. But you can't see right now that Alex is balancing a Rubik's Cube, an unsolved Rubik's Cube, I will add, on top of his head while we make a pitch here. The first sponsor for this episode is Instacart. Local fresh groceries from the local stores you love delivered right to your front door in as little as 1 hour. So by following the link in the show notes, you can sign up for a 14-day free trial and get a free delivery on your first order of over $35. So using our link specifically lets Instacart know that we were the ones who sent you, which of course helps to support the show. They have multiple stores available. Shop at all of your favorite stores in one single order. Hand-selected by shoppers based on your preferences, Instacart highlights deals to help you save money, find everything you usually buy, and get smart suggestions for new items. They pick the freshest produce and keep your eggs safe, too. All right. Good job, Alex.
Thanks.
Wow. You didn't drop it at all. You dropped it after.
Dropped it at the end. Yeah, go figure.
So I didn't even realize this. I realized this after while I was down at my parents for 4th of July. So my mother does something similar to Instacart. She actually works for, it's not necessarily Instacart, and I won't say the competitor's name just because we have a sponsor, but, she does a similar thing. My mom will kind of, you know, she puts on a shirt, right? She goes into the store and she shops around for somebody. She works off of the app, right? So you as the Instacart person actually download the app and, you know, select the produce that you want delivered to your home in as little as an hour. And then I was like, oh, and mom's just kind of doing this as like a side gig while she makes handbags and stuff like that. She has her own business going on, but as she's out and about, she'll just kind of clock in like an Uber driver. Right. And she'll just be like, hey, while I'm here at the store, I'm going to grab some stuff for somebody else. And she delivers it to them. And she's really like happy about it. Like it's something that she like enjoys doing. And it's cool. It's kind of like, it kind of has like a Meals on Wheels type of feel. But for like everybody, you know, like she's had a lot of fun experiences delivering food to people. So
well, and just imagine, folks, for those listening, imagine if you were to start this episode, or I should say, you could use our link and place an order and then see whether or not by the time this episode ends, if your Instacart is delivered. Wouldn't that be something?
Absolutely. Yeah.
If anybody's willing to test that out and give it a try, definitely give it a shot.
And go. But the link is in the description of the show, guys. So if you follow that link, you sign up for a 14-day free trial, you get a free delivery on your first order of over $35. So, that's something that we can offer to you guys as our watchers and listeners. So thanks for supporting the show. Test it out. See if it's a good fit. So I don't have a Rubik's Cube, Alex, but I do have a game called Totally 90s Trivia. It's 100 pop culture questions. I have one on here. So what is the name? Do you want to do one? Just one quick one.
Yeah.
Do you have time? All right. All right. What are you doing for the next hour? Anything? Which female group sang No Scrubs? Is it A, The Supremes, B, TLC, or C, En Vogue?
En Vogue.
Feel free to play along, everybody at home.
En Vogue?
It is not En Vogue. It is TLC.
TLC. Okay.
All right, one more. Jarvis Cocker was the front man for which British band? Is it A, Supergrass, B, The Stone Roses, or C, Pulp?
Oh, definitely the Stone Roses.
It is not the Stone Roses. It is.
Oh, Trump. Okay.
Well. Were you alive in the 90s? I don't. I wouldn't have gotten either of those right.
Under a rock, thank you. Under a great rock.
I would not have gotten either of those right. So anyway, weird plug for the 90s trivia game. If you want it, go get it. I'm going to try and balance this on my head while Alex, you announce the next sponsor.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are announcing the next sponsor being Buzzsprout. Buzzsprout is hands down the easiest and best way to launch, promote, and track your podcast. Your show can be online and listed in all the major podcast directories like Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, and more within minutes of finishing your recording. Podcast isn't hard when you have the right partners, and the team at Buzzsprout is passionate about helping you succeed. Join over 100,000 podcasters already using Buzzsprout to get your message out to the world. Buzzsprout, let's create something great together.
Ha!
Well done.
Thank you. I did. Yeah. My nose was like itching.
Itching. Like, oh, yeah, no, that, it always happens. Always happens there.
How do we do it? Yeah, Buzzsprout is great, guys. So another way that you guys can help support the show. So follow the link in the description. If you do sign up for a paid account with Buzzsprout, only about $12 a month. That's what we do, guys, and that's how we're keeping the show alive. Gets you a $20 Amazon gift card if you sign up for a paid plan, and it helps us support the show as well if you do that. So if you ever wanted to start your own podcast, do what we did and do what we're doing. We started with Buzzsprout because we liked it, and we're still here. It's a good platform. So
that's good. It's really good.
All right, let's dive into colonial life in America, leading up to the Revolutionary War. Alex, where do you feel like is a good place to kind of start this conversation?
Well, I think the good place to start, in my opinion, is always motivation, because what motivated the colonists to come to America to begin with? I mean, it obviously, to travel across an ocean for 3 to 4 weeks in good weather.
Right.
And that's only if the weather is good, which we all know that weather is rather unpredictable, especially now anyway.
Right.
I think that's a good place to start, because I feel like knowing a little bit more and discussing a little bit more about why they came in the first place.
Why the colonists came to America in the first place. I agree that's a very good place to start. I actually have one other thing that we should start with before we get into that, because we completely skipped over our beer.
Oh, of course. Yes. Yes. Well, I mean, we'll do it. All right, first.
Yeah, well, so if you watched last week's episode, both Alex and I grabbed Samuel Adams, the Samuel Adams that Alex is holding up right now, which is the summer ale with a little bit of citrus in grains of paradise, which we still don't know what those are. But I decided I was going to switch over to the Boston Lager just to give us some diversity. I still wanted to keep Samuel Adams here because I do think it's a perfect fit for what we're talking about. So this is the Boston Lager. If you've never had it, don't know what you've been doing, but this is pretty much a staple of Samuel Adams and the Boston Beer Company. So that's what I'm going to be drinking. And that's Alex, lovely.
I'll be doing
Samuel Jackson's.
I would definitely drink a Samuel Jackson beer.
I'm drinking a beer.
And he would also be a great Samuel Adams in a movie. Samuel Adams Summer Ale, Citrus Wheat Ale. Summer Ale is perfect for any summer day. Jim Couch, founder and brewer.
That one doesn't have specifically the dumping tea in the Boston Tea Party or anything like that?
No, it seems to have changed. I guess after the fourth,
After our episode aired, they're like, oh no, we got to stop that.
No, we got to stop the presses, because you know that business in the UK, they don't want the Queen to be angered at this point.
Right.
Because it's 245 years, my friend.
And so here's another thing. Another reason I switched is because I had that Leinenkugel's, the Summer Shandy, which is also kind of a citrusy summer beer. And it was too much citrus for me for two episodes in a row. I'm kind of going back to just the kind of the classic lager, which I think is going to be good. So.
Cheers, man.
Cheers to colonial life.
Hey, here's to Treason Day.
Colonial life. Why did the colonists come to America? What did you find, Alex? What were you kind of
as far as I can understand, and which I think is an interesting It's an interesting point to bring about, because I think that often America, we especially now, because we're 245 years removed from not even the colonies being founded, but by the country being founded, there was almost 170 years from when Jamestown was founded in 1607 to 1776. So if you think of that amount of time, like that's a long time.
Yeah.
And mind you, it took a little bit for things to actually like become, you know, somewhat stabilized, at least for the European groups that kept on coming. What I find interesting is that often, you know, a lot of the issues kind of stemmed from the fact that, you know, certain folks were Protestant, certain folks were Catholic, certain folks were Methodist, certain folks were Anabaptists. A lot of them came from these particular religious sects. That's a hard word to say.
Risky word, but yes, you got it.
S-E-C-T-S. Yes. You should look it up. King Henry VIII had like a daughter, and the daughter ended up becoming queen. What was interesting is that it essentially depended upon who was who. If they were Catholic or Protestant, the other side would usually bear a very bad brunt of persecution. And I don't mean like people making fun of another person. I mean like literally like they'd be thrown in jail or beheaded or, you know, whatever.
Or worse.
So some of the, as far as I understand, some of the initial push for the colonists came from just the fact it's like you want some place that you're not just going to get, you know, outright killed or persecuted by the king, depending on, you know, what the king, whether or not the king agrees with you.
Right.
So I think that's how some of it was founded, in particular with like the Puritans and stuff.
Right.
Some of the other ones, like Jamestown, was more specifically, and I think we tend to forget this, is that the colonies were started at the, some of these colonies were started at the commission of royalty. So, you know, like the king would be like, okay, here, you know, Sir Walter Raleigh, for instance, which is what we're named after, was an English guy who tried to found what is now the lost colony of Roanoke. And it was never successful. But it was just kind of one of those like, okay, we're going to, it's almost like how we view startups now, where it's just like, okay, I'm going to put some seed money in here and let's see and hope for the best whether or not, you know, this Virginia colony can actually take off. So anyway, that's how I've come to see it. What did you find?
I dove into a few things. So number one, I wanted to know if there were any other colonies other than on the Atlantic coast of America, right? That the British had. Because British have, you know, and throughout history have had colonies in different places, right?
The sun the sun never sat on the British Empire. That's the old saying. Right.
Yeah, and everything that I was looking at, I'm still kind of looking at it, honestly. I didn't really find a lot. Because I was thinking that there might be other colonies like in, like, I don't know if they were like in India or if they were like where they were at that time. And pretty much everything, bless you.
Excuse me.
Usually everything around like the British colonies around the 1600s, 1700s all kind of focuses on America. So I'm guessing this is kind of towards, and again, Alex and I kind of made this disclaimer last episode. We're not historians. We're not educated necessarily in this particular topic. So a lot of what we're doing is just kind of doing some general research and just having a conversation about it. And like we said in the last episode, a lot of these topics may be a little controversial since we are going to be talking about, you know, Native Americans, slavery, religion. There's going to be a lot of stuff that comes up that we're going to be we don't want to gloss over them. Those are very important topics, but we do want to talk about them, and it's important for us to talk about them, at least for us as individuals, to know that we can talk about them with each other, but also that we can share that conversation with other people, and we encourage other people to do the same. So anyway, from what I can see, I don't see a lot of other British expansion projects through in like the 1600s, 1700s, which was interesting to me. I thought they would have more colonies kind of in different places other than the UK, other than the island, right? So it's interesting that this is kind of, it kind of makes me feel like the American coast, the west or the east coast of America, was kind of this like project, almost like, hey, let's send some people away, right? And see if we can, you know, get more land, because the British weren't the only ones that were taking over land. The French had land in America, the South American countries were pushing up, Mexico and that kind of stuff. So they were pushing up into like kind of the Southwest too. So it's kind of like the British wanted to have their stake in that as well, and that kind of became like the East Coast of America, and they needed people colonizing that to kind of justify owning it, I guess, is mm-hmm. kind of how I see it. Mm-hmm. And that could be completely wrong, but that's just from what I've been looking at. Like, that just kind of seems like how that worked. Religiously, I feel like it's really weird because we have the Puritans, right? The Puritans are basically this group of people, from what I understand, that like just kind of they thought basically that the Church of England was basically being run too similarly to the Roman Catholic Church, mm-hmm. right? And they kind of started seeing that maybe the king was seeing himself as like the Pope of the Church of England,
right?
And they didn't like that, right? So they were kind of starting to basically like starting to separate from the king in that sense, religiously, from his religious perspective, not only of, you know, Christianity or Catholicism, because they are kind of mixed up, right, a little bit, but also just as the king, as how he saw himself within that role, right?
Yeah.
So you have the Puritans, right, who are basically like, we need to go by the Bible specifically, like what the Bible says is truth and what it is law as far as like our religious lives are concerned. But then you have people like the Quakers who came over too. Mm-hmm. And these are my descendants. I came from Quakers. And we have a pretty good documentation of my Quaker ancestors living in North Carolina, where Alex is now. And the Quakers were just this other type of mindset, completely mm-hmm. different, right? They felt like, you know, the Bible's up for interpretation, you know, there's other books, there's other thought processes out there that we can also use to live Christian lives. I don't even think they would have thought themselves to be Christians. I think they probably would have even fought that a little bit. So you kind of have like these polar opposite type of people, but they all kind of are united in this concept of, you know, we don't feel like we're able to practice our religious freedom in Britain. So if we want to practice our religious freedom, we need to go here, which is this new place that we still are British and we still belong to the crown, right? But we're free to kind of practice our own religious freedoms. And I just thought that was weird, because if they had, I'm sure they mixed and mingled too, right? Like on the boats and stuff going out across the ocean, being like, why are you going? Why are you going? They're like, oh, like we don't think like... Yeah, like we want to practice our religious freedom. We do too. What do you believe? And they're probably polar opposites, right? Mm-hmm. And then they're mm-hmm. like, we're all going to the same place. you go ahead. I know where you're going, but go ahead.
Well, and if you think about it too, where it's, I've always, when people are, you know, which I understand, sometimes folks who aren't Americans are very confused at America, like mm-hmm. its decision-making process. And I've always kind of prefaced this with saying, look, like America was founded on the principle of you can't tell me what to do, like regardless of of who it is. It's like regardless of the belief system in place, you know, you could be completely different in politics, in religion, in your life ethic as an American. But 9 times out of 10, the most common denominator is for anyone here in the United States is don't tell me what to do. And that, I think, to me, like, that's the uniting factor, and everything else gets kind of, you know, you butt heads, because literally that concept, you can butt heads into so many things with other people about that,
right.
Because then the question is like, well, how do you do laws, like if the actual ethic of your country is don't tell me what to do,
right?
How are laws put in place?
Right.
It's interesting, especially with the way the colonists would do things is, we can get into this topic too with like it's just a very different mindset in my head how I don't think of I don't think of who being my leader is going to directly affect me in my like what I can and can't read or worship or
by leader do. Do you have president in mind or do you just have any general type of government
I would I'm tempted to say president, but at the same time, and I think this is a really crucial difference that I as an American am really just becoming to better appreciate in our country is the fact that you're talking about a group of people that they had to deal with a certain person until that person was dead as king or queen.
Right.
And you have some very particular, I mean, if you read history, like one of the kings, like during the colony age was just certifiably insane. Like he was considered having a lot of like I think he was suffering from, it wasn't dementia or schizophrenia, but there's something very specific that you're kind of like,
mental
okay,
illness, yeah.
Yeah. Some kind of mental illness that was at the time not really treatable.
Right.
But he's a king. Like there's no way around it. So the issue is that there I'm sure there would have been some senses of like, well, how do you deal with this? Well, we don't know. Well, okay, this seems really uncertain. We could be stuck with this guy for 30 plus years, you know,
right.
What's the deal with that? So I definitely get the idea of like, if you want to travel 3,000 miles, you know, across an ocean, right. You want to talk about a great way to get away from decision-making having immediate impact on you is right. That it takes, you know, weeks for a king's, you know, issuance of a decree or something to actually, right. You know, take place in your own country. So you have a little bit of buffer time.
Right. And I just want to Google this real quick. This is something I should have looked up. I want to know how long this trip actually took.
I think it was 3 weeks.
3 weeks?
But I think it was 3 weeks, but it also widely depends on where you land. Because even if you look at the way that, I mean, you can look at the map here, the geography of where Boston is so much more jutted out towards the ocean, and it's closer to England than if you were traveling to North Carolina. Like that's an added, you know, several hundred miles.
All right, off just a little bit, 66 days, so just over 2 months.
Wow.
Yeah, that's from their departure on September 6th until, so this is specifically the Mayflower, departure on September 6th until Cape Cod was sighted on November 9th of 1620. Yep, that's crazy.
At least then they knew that it existed. Like I'm still, my mind is blown by folks that weren't just colonists but were explorers, in the fact that they had no idea. Maybe some semblance of an idea, but it's interesting.
2 months, 2 months of ocean, of Atlantic Ocean. This isn't a cruise,
cold.
People.
It's North, not like North Atlantic. Yeah.
Yeah, North Atlantic. Yeah. Yeah.
Isn't the Caribbean.
Right, exactly. Anyway, but yeah, it's so interesting. Yeah, you're right. I do like that, taking that concept of like, America did kind of start with that. You're just not going to tell us what to do, right?
Yeah.
And in a time where like, I mean, you kind of had to do whatever, you know, the king was telling you to do. I mean, there are, I do want to, and we have very American opinions about this, both of us do, and this is kind of why I'm still interested in exploring kind of the English side of it as well. There are instances, even with the colonies leading up to like, what we're talking maybe a year or two before the Revolutionary War, before the Declaration of Independence, mm-hmm. where we do see the monarchy kind of giving in a little bit and kind mm-hmm. of working with the colonies. It's not mm-hmm. like, I mean, I hate it. I understand why we villainize it. And because it's good story. It's good storytelling. If the British are just very great big villains in all of this, I don't necessarily want to bypass that. I think we're dealing with a portion of history where this really, at least from what I could see, hadn't really been done, where you have this kingdom that is trying to colonize another continent and still kind of organize them and help them through kind of, mm-hmm. you know, doing their own thing. Mm-hmm. It's interesting. And I think, it's, obviously intentions could have been good or bad or both, but it is interesting to kind of start kind of looking at it like that. And I guess before we get too far into it, I want everybody else to know I'm interested in that perspective, and I'm going to probably start pulling from that perspective a lot, just because I'm just naturally conditioned to be like, America, you know, like we fought the British tried to control us from over an ocean. They tried to tax us, taxation with our representation, and we stuck it to them, you know, and I think all that's great. And none of it's not really true. It's just like I'm kind of interested in exploring something else too. But it is cool to kind of see all the different religions that were mm-hmm. kind of here, right?
Mm-hmm.
All at once. You had Quakers, you had, who else do we have here? So it's a mixture of religions and Quakers, who founded Pennsylvania, Catholics, mm-hmm. Lutherans, mm-hmm. a few Jewish communities.
Anabaptists.
Yeah. Southern colonists were a mixture of Baptists and Anglicans, it sounded like.
Mm-hmm.
So.
You mean sorry? Anglicans?
Anglicans. I don't know why. Anglicans. It's Anglicans? Right. What's an Anglican?
Angelica. Yeah, I don't know. All right, I'll take it. Yeah, it's an interesting thing to think that for America, at least this is what I've seen, is that in our view in the colonies, the colonists moved here for the sake of opportunity,
mm-hmm.
for whatever that is, opportunity for freedom, opportunity for space. Certainly the land was cheaper, mainly just because they're just like, they put a stake in the ground. They're like, this is ours. But like yeah. you, that was just, you know, I guess how it was done. But one thing that's interesting to me is also to think that England had a very particular set of beliefs about the English way. The French had a very specific belief that this is the French way, and that even the Dutch mm-hmm. or the Spaniards or the Portuguese, like, you know, way back in the 1500s, when the Spaniards and the Portuguese were like the dominant forces in the world at the time, you know, all these particular nations had this belief that like the best place on earth is a place that if it's run under English, French, Dutch law. Mm-hmm. So to have these colonies was a very shrewd way of giving these people quote unquote freedom to be able to, you know, do what they right. wanted to do. Right. But it also gave their empires resources right. in a way that, you know, the island of England is tiny comparatively mm-hmm. speaking to the vast majority of any. I mean, I think the UK as a nation is smaller than the state of California. Like, just to kind of give you a perspective of size. So it's like
geographically.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So like it's obviously it's, you know, it's not tiny, but at the same time, I rephrase what I said. It's not tiny, but it's not particularly big either. So if you think of the way that the empires and them setting up colonies, it was a very clever way to extend their reach mm-hmm. and all, but you know, let's be honest, they probably just needed more cloth and sugar and indigo and all the number mm-hmm. of things that they were mm-hmm. wanting at the time.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, yeah. So it's a fascinating history.
It is. But now I'm glad we started there. Thank you for starting that off, Alex. So now we have the colonists that have gone from England across the ocean. Now they're mm-hmm. in the colonies on the East Coast, kind of exploring kind of what that colonial life was like. I first, of course, since I'm into beer and board games, I kind of started looking into colonial life and colonial board games. And I came across a game called Nine Men's Morris, which apparently is like one of the first colonial like board games that they were playing. And I wanted to play it with you.
All right. What
do you
want to
play? Do you want to play Nine Men's Morris? I'm gonna show you. So yeah, give me one second. All right. So this is Nine Men's Morris. I've never played this before. I didn't look up how to play this. So we're going to learn it together. Are you ready?
Yeah, let's do it.
Okay. So how to play. Place all of your pieces. So this is a website called toytheater.com. And obviously, if you're listening on the podcast, we are now on a website. So again, if you want to know what's going on, just join us on the video version. You can see what we're playing and how to play Nine Men's Morris. How to play. Place all of your pieces, men, on the board and move them to form a line of three pieces, which is a mill. Once you form a mill, you can remove one of your opponent's men, break a mill to unlock the mill's unlock the mills again. Pieces from a form. This is a lot more complicated than I thought it was going to be. I thought it was going to be like tic tac.
They had to occupy their time. They had to occupy the time somehow.
Yeah, pieces from a formed mill can't be removed unless no other men are available. Your aim is to leave your opponent with either two pieces or zero moves. Cool. Let's try it. Set your men on the board. I'm gonna put mine right there. Where do you want yours?
Bottom right.
Bottom right, right here.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're black.
Great.
I'm going to put mine right there.
Oh. Oh, dang. So you win?
Remove a man from the opponent's. So I'm going to remove. Okay, I see what's going on here. So I'm going to remove this guy.
Great. Remove the one down below.
This one?
Nope. That one.
This one?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So it's my turn.
Put me... Oh, okay.
My turn. Don't steal my turn. All right. Yeah, so that's how you play.
Yeah, I'm good if we stop.
Okay, cool. We'll call it a draw. We'll call it a draw. So that's Nine Men's Morris. That's apparently a game that they would play. I thought it was going to be like tic-tac-toe or something like 5 seconds long. I didn't think it was going to be like a game of Risk or something. You just sit on there forever. But yeah,
funny.
Nine Men's Morris. That's how you play. Apparently, so like if you get like usually when you had a game of like checkers, right? Mm-hmm. Old games of checker, like old checker boards, would have like that design on the back of it, so you could play Nine Men's Morris too. So you kind of had like one game on the top, like the checkerboard, and then you had Nine Men's Morris on the back.
On the back, yeah. Those are cool.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yep. Other pastimes that colonial children would do. Simple things like hopscotch. Flying a kite, playing London Bridge, shuttlecock, which is pretty much badminton, riding a horse, sewing a stitch, spinning a top, rolling a marble, doing the hoop roll.
Have you done the hoop roll?
The hoop roll.
Yeah. Bang, bang, yeah. Bang, bang. Yeah. Yep.
Blind man's bluff, which I still don't know how to play. Game of horseshoes, little wood. You know the stuff. You know the stuff. Yeah.
Classic. Classic. Yeah.
Have you ever been to Connor, like I call it Connor Prairie because there's a place in Indianapolis called Connor Prairie where it's like they live back in the day, right? Colonial times, and they pretend like, you know, they have actors that kind of, or if you're a child and you're impressionable, those are real people living all the way back then, and you're actually going back in time. So
it's impressive.
For all you children out there.
Got some in your eye?
Yeah, actually. Thanks for mentioning it. Did you ever have like a place like that nearby where you could go?
I mean, there's Williamsburg, there's Mount Vernon, there's Monticello, there's
okay.
I mean,
so that's a yes. All right.
Yes. Take your pick in Virginia, man. It is it's the cradle of a lot of those kind of beginning things. So
Yeah.
And my aunt lived within driving distance of Plymouth in Massachusetts. So on the occasion when I was a kid, we would go to Plymouth and actually, you know, witness Plymouth Rock, which is, you know, a very hard rock.
I've always just pictured it as this huge boulder on a hill.
It's just a big rock, man. And there's a carving on it.
Is that where it is? You know,
yeah, it's a big old rock.
I'm going to take a look.
Plymouth Rock is quite the showstopper, I gotta say.
Is it? No, it's not. Look at that. It looks very small, actually.
Yeah, it's not huge.
Why is it?
Why is it a thing?
I was just gonna say, like, Plymouth Rock is obviously like it's like a hill or something. It's like where they landed, right? It wasn't like a physical rock.
There is a physical rock.
I understand. I'm staring at a physical rock, but that's not what the Mayflower landed on. It was
no. It didn't land on a rock. It landed in Plymouth, like the area. Plymouth Rock, as far as I understand, was essentially just made as a marker, kind of like a "Hey, we're here" kind of thing. As far as I understand, could be wrong.
Yeah, I guess I never understood that. I always just thought Plymouth Rock was like a huge rock that the Mayflower basically just like rolled in and like tipped over on the side of. Like, this is Plymouth Rock.
Sounds like somebody out of Monty Python.
So I kind of wanted to visit as well, just go ahead and have this conversation because it needs to be had. Just the conversation with who already lived here before the colonists came. I'm gonna pass it off to you, Alex, just because I know you have things you want to say about this as well. I don't want to start glazing over anything, but yeah.
Well, it is an interesting thing, I think, to know about our present. It's always crucial to understand what the past that we went through, as in particular as a country, in terms of how we started things up. One, we were colonies. We were not set up originally as an area that happened because a king happened to beat another king in a war and then was like, okay, this is a country, is ours now. Like, yeah. We were set up specifically by countries, not here, and it was commissioned to go and set up these colonies. So that's, I think that's important, is to know that essentially it was there's more nuanced ways to put it, but it was kind of bluntly a mercenary kind of endeavor, where knowing that the royalty and themselves were like, great, you know, we don't really care how you do it, but this will be set up as a colony. And I think that was one thing. I think another thing too, that was a very unfortunate, and even as a Christian, like it's an unfortunate part of the past. It tends to not go over well when you mire the politics of a certain situation, in this case 1600s Europe, and essentially you, in the name of God and country, you essentially are like, all right, guys, go and therefore and conquer. The collision of new nation, collision of these colonies coming, or colonists coming in, with these entire systems of people, of you know, cultures that had already been there for, you know, however many thousands of years at this point. So it wasn't as if like we put a foot in the ground and were like, oh, this new sandcastle's ours. We built it ourselves.
Right.
Like, there are people that were already here. So for instance, as a Virginian, I know the Algonquin people were pretty prevalent at the time. If you look in Virginia, it's either Old English names or it is Native American names. Chesapeake is a Native American name. Shenandoah is a Native American name. Rappahannock is a Native American name. Like, you could just keep adding to the list.
Right.
The somewhat haunting thing about it, though, is that none of them are here anymore. Mm-hmm. Some places in the West, I think the United States as a governmental body, we talked about this in the West episode over a year ago.
Forever ago.
Wow, feels like a long
shout
time.
Shout out to the American West episode, episode two.
Pre-pandemic. I think that's one thing to just know, is that I think a lot of people on both sides were kind of operating, unfortunately, out of fright of the other. And it was just like, well, I got to protect my family, you know, on both sides. So it's like, to whatever means, I'm going to do that. And it just so happened that, you know, the Europeans had guns, initially. But also, I think the other thing is that, unfortunately, you know, we tend to forget this with the way we understand medicine and science in terms of germs today. It's like, back then, people just died because of plagues and so on and so forth, yellow fever and whatnot. And there were a lot of people that just died just from the interaction of Europeans landing in North America and in other spots.
Smallpox, specifically.
Smallpox, any number of those things. Now, mind you, malaria back in those days was not pleasant for the colonists either, and a lot of people died from that as well. However, it is just, I think, on a historical level, it is unfortunate on so many levels that there could not have been a better way to actually have done it. But at the same time, like, it's, and again, our country was founded on this thing, so it's really hard to peel back the layers. However, I think it is important to note that there were a lot of times, and I think this is really important to remember, at least what I have discovered, is that the Native American people groups operated very similar to the way we, in some ways, operate either as states or as countries, where there were certain peoples that lived in Virginia,
right,
that had modern day Virginia, that had a very specific way of operating of their people, of their government, you know, their governmental structure, leadership structure, whatever, right, that was very different than how the Iroquois up north would operate, right, which was different than how the I'll think of the name later, but there's a lot of folks that dwelled in the area of New York City, where the New York City area was a place you go in the summers, not the winter, and because mm-hmm. obviously the cold, so you'd move in to what was New Jersey, or what is now New Jersey, mm-hmm. and they would move in during that time and then come back out, and you know, they'd fish and whatever.
Yeah, right.
So a lot of these folks were like in kind of different countries themselves. So I think a lot of the conflict, where sometimes colonists would run into situations where they would be fighting for their lives, and vice versa, with Native Americans against mm-hmm. the colonists. But then there were other situations where certain people groups actually wanted to try to work with the colonists mm-hmm. because they had particular resources that the Native Americans of that area didn't have, right. and you know, and vice versa. So it's very complex.
Right. Very complex. Super complex. Yeah. And I've never thought of the Native American nations operating that way, but I think that's somewhat accurate, right? That you did have, you know, you had the Iroquois, and then you had, you know, the different nations that all probably knew about each other and all probably worked together in some fashion, or probably butted heads with each other in some fashion.
Yeah.
Right. But yeah, and how they were kind of split up that way, which leads to, because yeah, and I would encourage anybody who, you know, if you're a young listener or a young viewer, if you're just kind of learning about these stories, I remember as a kid just kind of gumming them all up into cowboys and Indians, right? Like, it's just
right.
Like, that's just a very childhood thing to do. I'm not ashamed that I was brought up that way. It's just a very natural thing that happened, I guess, as far as, you know, childhood, right? But yeah, I always just kind of thought of them. I always just thought of like the Native Americans as kind of like this big group of people, and it's just not the case. So it's kind of like today, like we have, you know, you are living in North Carolina, I'm living in Michigan. There's different political things that are going on in our parts yep. of the country, and the yep. similar. It was very similar, likely, back in 1400s, 1500s, 1600s, that the Native Americans, you know, were doing something similar. They were handling their own business. They were doing their own thing. They had their own routine. And then they, obviously you get European expansion that's coming into these colonies, and they had different approaches to how that they wanted to deal with that. That at least makes sense to me. And that's probably why we have a lot of different stories throughout history of very, very violent clashes with the Native Americans yeah. and the colonists, and very peaceful interactions between Native Americans and colonists. So I think it's healthy to just start there, right? And to say, if you can just realize that there's these different groups that were separate, not only as a familial structure, right, but as what could be considered a governmental structure, right, and different religious beliefs maybe, and how they dealt with new colonists coming in. So I think that's a healthy way to approach that conversation. But yes, definitely. Had a reaction to the type of diseases that Europeans were bringing in with them, which was not to their benefit at all. And then also, I mean, we do have a slave trade that's being generated right around this time. So and unfortunately, Native Americans were kind of pulled into that as well. So a lot of sad stories and sad realities circling around that conversation, but. Definitely isn't something that we can talk about, this whole early colonial life, without going through that. I do like when I hear a story, and I don't have one specifically pulled up or else I'd share it, but of those peaceful interactions, we do see kind of that image that we all kind of hope to think of, right, when Thanksgiving rolls around, you know, where we think about, you know, the pilgrims and the Native Americans coming together around one big table and eating. I know that's not necessarily like exactly how it happened, right? Mm-hmm. But mm-hmm. like, I do like stories when there are stories out there of very peaceful communal interactions, you know, as well as the bad stories. And unfortunately, the negative stories, I think, outweigh the good, because I think in whole and as a whole in the history of it all, it did end up being kind of a one-sided thing. So, but anyway, I do want to mention that. I do also want to talk about the French Revolutionary War, where the Native Americans were, not the French Revolutionary War, the French and Indian War. Well, here, let's just do this. Alex, I know you got something planned for it. So how about you take it from here and,
sure.
and I'll learn some more from you.
So the French and Indian War was, one, it's a very confusing name for a war, let's be honest, because it was the colonists.
I'm very confused.
It was the colonists and Mother England.
Oh, okay.
Excuse me. Who fought against the French.
That's right.
And okay. I think the misconception is that, and again, it's like one of those things where it's like you forget that, like, yeah, there were a lot of different people groups that were existing all over this area. Like, this whole, I mean, look at this. It's like 3,000 miles across. I mean, mm-hmm. it's like there's a huge swath of land here. So, the French had a lot of folks that were Native Americans who did side with them, but there were also ones that sided with the British. And so, like, essentially these clashes ended up happening. And I can give you kind of a basic outlook. So, I wrote this down. So it began in the Ohio Valley, and the British America was taking land westward from the 13 colonies. So if you want to basically essentially draw a line around the Appalachian Mountains, mm-hmm. that was essentially the limit of where the British colonies usually would go. So they were slowly but surely starting to expand westward.
Midwest, yeah.
Right, which is Midwest now, but like westward was
it
was considered far west back then. So they were doing that, and the new French areas were heading south from modern-day Quebec and Detroit. So they were basically up here, and they were working their way down Detroit, St. Louis, and New Orleans.
French explorer that we were talking about with the mm-hmm. maps episode that discovered the Niagara Falls area.
Exactly. Yeah. So they're essentially on a collision course to kind of just run into each other. So it was a war over Ohio Valley for a strategic advantage and the vast resources that they saw. And then just one of the highlights as well is that the war saw the rise of a then 21-year-old lieutenant colonel, which was George Washington. So that was his big kind of, that war was one of the reasons why he ended up becoming more well-known. So
Butterbar's second lieutenant. So when you first become an officer, you become a second lieutenant, and mm-hmm. the rank is, I'm sure this wasn't the case back in the day, I'm just saying, but the rank is like a yellow or gold bar. So we call it Butterbar.
Butterbar George. I like that. So just to give you, again, to refer this, though it was called the French and Indian War, not all Native Americans, people groups in that region sided with the French. For instance, the Iroquois Confederacy chose no side until they joined the British in 1758. Another highlight that came out of the war was that the ragtag colonists that fought alongside the British was the inspiration for the song Yankee Doodle Dandy, which is so it was originally meant as an insult, and then per American character of ourselves, it became a badge of honor during the revolution. Right. Which I was like, yeah, stick it to the man. I like
can't
that.
Tell us what to do. You can't even insult us. We don't even understand that we're being insulted.
Yeah. You want to take our insult? Great. We'll turn it back on you. Yeah. So the British were losing for much of the war until William Pitt the Elder, who is actually the namesake of Pittsburgh, took control of the war effort. He doubled the British national debt to £140 million pounds, which is $26.46 billion for today. Or sorry, billion pounds, because it's British. And they ended up winning the Battle of Quebec and then forced France to sign the Treaty of Paris. And this established British dominance outside of Europe. But it also did one other important thing, is that it increased debt. And it led to the eventual taxing of their colonies, which essentially this war was the catalyst for what would become the American Revolution, because Britain needed more money.
And then that kind of starts leading into this taxation without representation type of conversation, which leads into the Stamp Act. So Stamp Act was passed in 1765. It was an act of the Parliament of Great Britain, which imposed a direct tax on the British colonies in America and required that many printed materials in the colonies be produced on a stamped paper produced in London carrying an embossed revenue stamp. So printed materials included legal documents, magazines, playing cards, newspapers, that kind of stuff. And a lot of this stuff was sold and moved throughout the colonies. It had to be paid in British currency, not in colonial paper money.
Yeah.
So the purpose of the tax was to pay for the British military troops stationed in American colonies after the French and Indian War.
The French and Indian War.
The colonists had never feared a French invasion to begin with, so they contended that they had already paid for their share of the war expenses. So this is where we kind of start to see a little bit of the clash, right? Mm-hmm. Colonists feel like they've already paid for their share of the war, and here is Mother England kind of asking them to do a little bit more. So the Stamp Act was unpopular for a few reasons. Majority of them, of the colonists, considered that it was a violation of their rights as Englishmen to be taxed without their consent. So this is the taxation without representation type of argument. Colonial assemblies sent petitions. So colonies had assemblies. So we didn't have Congress, right? We didn't have a Senate. Right. Each of the colonies had these assemblies, right? And this is before the Continental Congress was created. The Continental Congress, which was basically what wrote and declared the Declaration of Independence, right? So before that, you have these colonial assemblies. So New York had this, Massachusetts had this, Virginia had this, all the way down South Carolina. So all these different colonial assemblies. So they sent petitions and protests to the Stamp Act Congress, which was held in New York. So that was the first significant joint colonial response to any British measure when it petitioned Parliament and the King. So the first time that all the colonies came together to petition something was the Stamp Act. And it was basically this is basically what sparked this whole taxation through representation. You can't tell us what to do. All right. So one member of British Parliament argued that the American colonists were no different from the 90% of Great Britain. So this is part of the conversation that I missed or I wasn't interested in or something during grade school. And I kind of get it. Like I from a governmental standpoint, like I at least understand the X's and O's of it. I'm not emotionally involved, but like this is kind of the British Parliament's response, right? So they argued that the American colonists were no different from the 90% of Great Britain from 90% of Great Britain who did not own property and thus could not vote. Who were nevertheless virtually represented by land-owning electors and representatives who had common interests with them. So this was kind of the stance of the British Parliament, right? Like, technically, you don't own land in Britain, so you don't have this access, which I understand is, you know, we look back on and we can even kind of equate it to issues in our country now of people who should have rights who live here. But it's interesting to know that that was kind of how they saw it. It wasn't just, you know, you guys are colonists. We're Mother England. We're going to be horrible to you because we feel like it. There was some rationale behind that. And I like knowing kind of what that was, at least. One last thing that I want to say is, and again, this is just giving some perspective into England at the time. There were actually residents and merchants in England who were opposing the Stamp Act as well. It wasn't just the colonists. So merchants who traded with the colonies on a regular basis and whose income depended on the colonies did not want, they were also working with the colonists basically, or in agreement with the colonists, saying that it's taxation without representation and they shouldn't. So not only did you have the colonists in America who were saying that, but there was a kind of a revolution growing in England too, who supported the colonists. So I want to make sure I got that out.
So press the old colonial fast forward button to 1767 to the Townshend Acts. And it looks like it's pronounced Townshend Acts, but it's actually Townshend. It's a British name.
Yeah.
So it was passed by Parliament in 1767, and it was taxed goods to American colonies, such as British China, glass, lead, paint, paper, and tea. So The colonists protested, and through two pamphlets that were spread throughout the colonies, they began a boycott in New England over British goods. So mainly New England merchants within 24 towns throughout Massachusetts, Connecticut, and Rhode Island, which is neither a road nor an island, agreed that aside from necessities like fishing hooks and wire, they would not import British goods for a year. So in response to that, Britain sent in troops to occupy Boston and to quell the protests. So there were 2,000 troops that were sent for a 15,000-person city. So I was looking that up. That's basically 13% of the city's size is all of a sudden a military force that is occupied specifically to make people behave.
Yep.
So after the Boston Massacre, which we'll get to that next, all Townsend Act taxes would be repealed in April 1770, except for the tax on tea. We'll get into that later.
Yeah. Interesting. It is kind of interesting to see how all of this conflict begins kind of focusing in on one particular town. Right? Mm-hmm. And then in 1770... Something very important happens, something that's very sad happens. But we did have the Boston Massacre. And if you haven't watched John Adams, which is a television series called John Adams, which why can't I think of his name? What is it blanking?
Paul Giamatti.
Paul Giamatti, thank you. Paul Giamatti.
It's on HBO.
It was on HBO. Paul Giamatti plays the role of John Adams, and through this time period, right, the colonial period of the colonies, right, of the American colonies, before the American Revolution, then throughout the American Revolution, and then after the American Revolution, as they kind of start to figure out how to run a country. If you haven't watched that, please do. Find it on any whatever streaming platform you're on, wherever you can find it. It's a wonderful watch, and it starts off with this specific scenario, which is the Boston Massacre, which basically was a confrontation on March 5th of 1770, in which British soldiers shot and killed several people, American colonists, while being harassed by a mob in Boston. The event was heavily publicized by leading patriots such as Paul Revere and Samuel Adams. British troops had been stationed in the province of Massachusetts since 1768 in relation to the Townsend Acts in order to support the crown appointed officials and to force unpopular parliamentary legislation, which Alex just went over. So amid tense relations between the civilians and the soldiers, a mob formed around a British sentry and verbally abused him. He was eventually supported by seven additional soldiers led by Captain Thomas Preston, who were hit by clubs, stones, and snowballs. So again, this is not, and I just feel like initially when you learn about the Boston Massacre, it just sounds like a whole bunch of innocent people were shot.
Mm-hmm.
There is another version of that story, right, that we're kind of hearing in this, and where I pulled this information from. I mean, American colonists were being kind of aggressive, right? Yeah. So again, I'm just fascinated by that because I don't love that this happened, but I do like knowing the full details, right? And it sounds like a very aggressive mob for very political reasons and very passionate reasons, which I get. But it's not just a one-sided thing. So eventually one soldier fired, prompting the others to fire without an order by Preston. The gunfire instantly killed three people and wounded eight others, two of whom later died of their wounds. So kind of where this story gets a little interesting to me as far as the John Adams, Samuel Adams conversation gets concerned. John Adams was living in Boston at the time, and he actually takes the case. He takes the role to defend Preston, Captain Thomas Preston, and his soldiers during this. So the crowd eventually dispersed after Acting Governor Thomas Hutchinson promised an inquiry. But they reformed the next day, prompting the withdrawal of the troops to Castle Island, which I'm not sure where Castle Island is, but it sounds like it's away from the mainland. Eight soldiers, one officer, and four civilians were arrested and charged with murder, and they were defended by future U.S. President John Adams. Six of the soldiers were acquitted. The other two were convicted of manslaughter and given reduced sentences. The two found guilty of manslaughter were sentenced to branding on their hand.
Ow.
So, but another interesting thing that I don't remember learning in grade school, like one of our founding fathers defended legally the captain and the soldiers of the Boston Massacre who shot American colonials. Mm-hmm. And just another great representation of, you know, like the legal system and believing in a system and believing in rights, you know, despite our political differences. You know, John Adams was saying, and I'm sure he got flack for it too. But saying like, no, these men deserve representation and I'm going to give representation. And actually in the John Adams show, it's cool to kind of see him. He's wearing the wig and everything, you know, they got like the whole British, you know, courtroom
British style
set up. Yeah. Going up. So, give that show a watch. It's amazingly educational and also very entertaining too. And Paul Giamatti does his best work, I feel like, in that show. So take a look.
Yeah.
All right. What came next after that, Alex?
So next game, well, I'm sure a few things in between, but the next big highlight is once again, a little bit of a Boston vibe, the Boston Tea Party. Ladies and gentlemen, I've been looking forward to telling you about this one for a long time. 1773. December. It's one of the more famous American protests occurred at Griffin's Wharf. We all still know about it. If you say Boston Tea Party, most people know what you're talking about here in America. Mm-hmm. While the British saw these continued taxes as fair due to the war and paying off debts, the colonists were furious due to the fact of having still no representation in Parliament and being taxed, essentially no control for their own destiny within the empire as they saw it. The Boston Massacre further enraged colonists. And then 1773, Britain enacted the Tea Act, which allowed the British East India Company to sell tea to the colonists duty-free and much cheaper than other tea companies. So essentially, you limit any other competition, and you have to buy from this one particular thing, company. So in the, and I should add, too, like, this is one of those things where, like, I think people need to understand today is that tea for the colonies was just as essential as what tea is now for Britain or England, or England, India, you know, those kind of countries. Where now I would say probably America is more of a coffee drinking nation than tea. But back then, like, tea was like the thing. So just to give context.
Tea
and beer. Right, exactly. So in December of 1773, a large group of men dressed up in Native American garb with tomahawks boarded the docked ships and threw 342 chests of tea into the Boston Harbor. It took nearly 3 hours for more than the 100 colonists to empty the tea. They had to split open the chests first, so they had to take the axe and then open it up and then dump it out. The chests in total were more than 90,000 pounds of tea, which is 45 tons, so it would have cost nearly $1 million in today's money. In the aftermath of this is that there were a couple of different responses. Different famous Americans had varying opinions. So John Adams was very pleased, not particularly surprising as a Massachusetts man. George Washington, though supporting the cause of Boston as the cause of America, actually strongly disapproved of the actual tea dumping. His whole thing, and the other person that notably did not agree with it was Benjamin Franklin. He insisted that the British East India Tea Company be reimbursed for the lost tea and even offered to pay for it himself. So in particular, those two, I think, had some very strong feelings about the kind of the sacredness of private property, so to speak. Now, I will say, on a positive side, no one was hurt, and aside from the tea and a padlock, no property was damaged or looted beyond that kind of thing. It was a very specific action. So it was reported that the... that the colonists that dumped the tea actually swept the ship's decks clean before they left.
No way. You think so? You think that actually happened?
I don't know. Like, to me, it would almost make sense, because I would think them almost being like, how do we annoy the British as much as possible?
Right. It's kind of more insult to injury.
Let's clean it all up and just make it look like we didn't do a thing. So, ladies and gentlemen, that is the Boston Tea Party.
The Boston Tea Party. Man, so interesting.
What happens next?
Yeah, so by this point, Boston has a big red target on it. The British don't stop. I mean, they just kind of keep piling on these taxes and these different laws that now apply specifically to Boston. So they do this in a series of four things called the Coercive Acts. So the first one is the Boston Port Act, which was a direct response to the Boston Tea Party, which authorized the Royal Navy to blockade Boston Harbor because of the commerce of His Majesty's subjects cannot safely be carried there. I wonder why he said that. Then you had the Massachusetts Government Act. Again, these are very specified. Three of these acts are very focused on one town in particular, and that is Boston. So the second one was the Massachusetts Government Act. The Massachusetts Council, previously constituted as an elected body with the governor's approval, became appointed by the crown. So basically there's a council that talks to the governor, right, and advises the governor of Massachusetts. And that is those people who were in that position were taken away. And the king said, I want these people to be in that council. So not great, not a very good decision. Additionally, the act gave the new royal governor the ability to choose judges and county sheriffs without the council's approval. So yeah. County sheriffs could now also appoint jurors, harming the impartiality of the colony's judicial system. The government act also restricted town meetings to once a year, with any additional meetings requiring the governor's approval. Once a year. Not going to get a lot of done. One meeting a year. And then you had the Administration of Justice Act. So this law sought to further increase the power of the governor by giving him the ability to move a trial to another colony or Great Britain if it was determined that an indifferent trial cannot be had within the said province. The act eliminated the right to a fair trial by one's peers, removing the established judicial principle dating to the Magna Carta. And then finally, you have the Quartering Act, which is the only one of the four acts that apply to all of the colonies, not just Massachusetts or Boston. Mm-hmm. So it allowed high-ranking military officials to demand better accommodations for troops and to refuse inconvenient locations for quarters. Now, something that is a little misunderstood about this, all right, so the act did not require colonists to house soldiers within their private homes, which is the common belief. Rather, it specifically indicated that soldiers were to be housed in uninhabited houses, outhouses, barns, or other buildings, yet they were to be quartered at the colonists' expense. So it specifically indicated that soldiers were to be housed in other housing, like barns and stuff like that, but that the colonists had to pay for it. So it's not like colonists were forced to bring soldiers into their private homes and put them in their bedroom, right?
Right,
it's not what it required, but it still cost them money. So,
still annoying.
Those are the coercive acts.
Man, that was that's an unfortunate group of decisions.
Yeah, that all came kind of one after the other, right? And now we're kind of, this is 1774. This is 2 years before the Declaration of Independence. So now we're starting to get a little heated at this point.
Ramping up. Well, yep. I could go to what happens the next year in 1775, which is 1 year before 1776. Mm-hmm. I'm going to focus on ends up happening between and what is known as Lexington and Concord. Now, for those of you who are not Americans listening to this and are unfamiliar, so Lexington and Concord are two towns that are in Massachusetts. Concord is not as in Concord Grape or as in the jet, but as in actual, this is a town.
Thank you for clearing that up. Thank you.
Yeah, well, just in case. So Lexington and Concord are two Massachusetts towns that are essentially within horse riding distance. But during this time, it occurred on April 19th, 1775. So this is largely considered the beginning of the American Revolutionary War. This is what tips the scales towards the war actually happening. So on the night of April 18th, 1775.
Do you want to cue the colonial music?
Yeah,
cue the colonial music.
Yep. And flutes.
Bald eagle.
And bald eagle. And seal. All right. There we go. On the night of April 18th, 1775, hundreds of British troops marched from Boston to nearby Concord to seize an arms cache. being weapons, not actual human arms. Joseph Warren, a physician and a member of the Sons of Liberty, this was an inside, kind of an insider group, sent out two men to raise the alarm to the residents of Lexington Concord. One was a tanner named William Dawes, and the other was a silversmith named Paul Revere.
I've heard of him.
Yeah. The two went out in separate directions in case one was captured. Revere crossed the Charles River by boat, and that river is right near Boston in particular. Revere crossed the Charles River by boat to get to Charlestown, where fellow patriots were waiting for a signal of the movement of the British troops. They had been instructed to look at the steeple of Boston's Old North Church, which was visible to them because it was the highest point in the city. One lantern meant British movement by land, two lanterns by sea. Two lanterns were hung. So this moment in American history was then memorialized in Paul Revere's Ride, which was a poem by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. And I'm sure much of you can probably at some point in the back of your childhood minds probably familiar with this phrase. One if by land, two if by sea, and I on the opposite shore will be, ready to rise and spread the alarm through every Middlesex village and farm. And then it, you know, goes on. So... Revere and Dawes then rode through the night and met up in Lexington and convinced revolutionary leaders, Samuel Adams, and John Hancock to flee. Dawes and Revere then continued their journey. They met a third rider, Samuel Prescott, who was making his way to Concord. Revere was captured by a British patrol. Dawes was, unfortunately, thrown off his horse and forced to go back to Lexington on foot. On the morning of the 19th, 700 troops, British troops, arrived in Lexington and came upon 77 militiamen. The militia had been ordered to disperse when a shot rang out. To this day, we don't actually know who shot first. The British army then continued to Concord to try to find more arms. Of the little they found, the Patriots had thereby removed and or had destroyed most of it already. The British decided to burn the rest. The fire got a little out of control, and the militiamen in the surrounding area thought mistakenly that the town was actually being burned by the British, and they all began to move to Concord's North Bridge in response. So the British then shot first, but fell back once the colonists returned the volley. This was called the Shot Heard Round the World, which was again later memorialized by Ralph Waldo Emerson, apparently. Sorry, I said again like it was the same guy. So
yeah, I was like, that's not again.
Yeah. Ralph Waldo Emerson would memorialize that. So after searching Concord for about 4 hours, the British began to return to Boston. And this part I didn't realize. So they began to return to Boston 18 miles away. So they have to march from Concord to Boston, and all the colonists have already come across them and are like, pew, pew, you know, well, more like, pew.
Yeah.
Wait for it.
How's your day going?
Yeah, how's it going? You got any plans?
Well, we're shooting at you.
I gotta sew the. I gotta sew my. Hold on. You know these weapons aren't really handy.
Hold on while I make my own bullets.
Right. Quote Shakespeare while I do it. So, but here's the thing that really got me that I actually didn't realize until I read more about this. So there were, by then there were almost 2,000 militiamen, also known as the Minutemen, by their ability to come at moment's notice. So they had already descended, and there were more people, there were more militiamen showing up. And so the British still had to, they had to march 18 miles. So at first, the colonists just like, followed the British. Didn't do anything. They just kind of followed them. And then the fighting began. So the colonists would fire behind trees, stone walls, houses, etc. And the British began abandoning weapons, clothing, equipment, so they could essentially retreat faster. So just imagine if you're a British guy. I mean, that'd be pretty scary, frankly.
Yeah, terrifying.
So this hit and run tactic continued until the British reached the safety of the Charlestown Neck, where they had naval support. And also, quick fact, at that point, the American had no navy. So there was that thing. So the impact of this particular battle is it proved that to the sister colonies, like Virginia, et cetera, that the colonists had what it took to take on what was then the most powerful military force in the world due to the low casualty count, considering the situation. So
right.
That is Lexington and Concord in a rather big nutshell.
and a revolution was started. And then after that, we have the Revolutionary War, and we're going to get into all of that here in next week's episode. We're going to call it quits for now, though. I'm going to finish my beer and take a nap.
So, watch The Patriot 2.
The Patriot 2? What, there's a second one?
No.
Oh, okay.
It's Patriot 1777, because no one knows what happens then.
Just people farming.
Right. Hey, guys, the war's happening. Yeah. Great. I still need to farm these beets. Yeah, great. I don't know why I thought of beets, but, you know, that's all right.
Yeah. Beet farmers. Beet farmers are important.
Yeah, they are.
They contribute to society. That's our show, guys. Thanks for watching. Thanks for listening. Before we leave, we do want to give a shout out to our sponsors one more time. We want to make sure that you guys are aware that we are sponsored by Instacart, which is local fresh groceries from local stores that you love delivered right to your front door in as little as, how long, Alex?
1 hour.
In as little as 1 hour. That's like 60 minutes.
Yep.
That you could have produce at your door. Okay, anyway. So by following the link in the show's notes, you can sign up for a 14-day free trial and get the free delivery on your first order over $35. So using the link specifically lets Instacart know that you were the ones, or so that we were the ones who sent you, which of course helps us support the show. Mm-hmm. They have multiple stores available in your area on their app, so you can shop all of your local favorites in a single order. They have hand-selected shoppers. They have shoppers who hand select the produce for you for your order and based off of your preferences. Instacart highlights deals to help you save money. Find everything you usually buy and get smart suggestions for new items. They pick the freshest produce and keep your eggs safe too.
Very important. Got to have eggs that are safe.
Yes. Yes, you
do. The other, of course, sponsor, ladies and gentlemen, is Buzzsprout. So Buzzsprout is hands down the easiest and best way to launch, promote, and track your podcast. Your show could be online and listed in all the major podcast directories like Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, and more within minutes of finishing a recording. Podcast isn't hard when you have the right partners, and the team of Buzzsprout is passionate about helping you succeed. You are able to join over 100,000 podcasters already using Buzzsprout to get your message out to the world. Buzzsprout. Let's create something great together.
Together, Buzzsprout.
If you follow the links in the show notes, you'll be letting Buzzsprout know that it was us who sent you. So it also gets you, as well, a $20 Amazon gift card if you signed up for a paid plan. And, of course, it helps support our show, which we would be very happy.
We would. Happened. We would. Yes. Yep. And yes, we'll would. And let us know if you start a podcast. We'll start listening to it as well.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Thanks for watching, listening, guys. Be sure to like, subscribe, and comment. Those are other ways that you can help support the show.
Very helpful.
We'll see you guys next week to go over some untold stories of the American Revolution. But until then, guys.
Be happy.
Brew happy.
And game on.
Cheers.
Cheers. So... What I want to know is, like, why do they call it the Tea Party? Why not just, like, the Tea Throw or something like that? Yeah, right?
the Boston Tea Massacre.
That might have been the first one, and then the guy who's like, no, Jerry, we used it last time. Fine. All right, party. Let's go with party.